Plenty in Generous is great. We've been already flooded with clunk and slow tutorials when he combined old-school trance sound with techno. Charlie Sparks made a similar effort, combining into techno psytrance vibes. Let's acknowledge his skills too and take a close look onto how does he produce such rhythms. This tutorial is about creating a kick drum and bassline with only Ableton effects and samples, and the lead synthesizer comes from my Rave Techno Serum preset and sample pack. With over 40 plus quality bass, lead, pad presets, percussion samples and MIDI melodies, you will easily find sounds that suit hard techno kick and bass patterns. Find more details on the RTR website, and if you want to get a 5€ discount for this pack, please fill out the survey from the description box to help me develop a next sample pack. First things first, we will create the psytrance-like bassline. You will be surprised to discover how easy this sound is. After loading the wavetable synth with initial preset, we immediately change the waveform into a sort of wave with the wavetable position fader. The bassline I have created in the MIDI clip looks far different from what we hear. That is because the saw wave doesn't stop playing immediately when each MIDI note ends playing. And, as always, we fix that in the volume envelope window. That unnecessary fadeout is caused by too long release. Let's shorten it. I will also adjust the attack parameter to give the sound a very short fade-in, and work with decay and sustain to make the volume of the bass drop rhythmically. The next step is to get rid of the high end with a low pass filter. For that, I just turn down the frequency knob. To slightly enhance the mid-frequencies, I will use filter resonance knob to create a bump around the cutoff frequency. Because there are no filter modulations involved, it's as if we equalize this bass sound. Wavetable synth has a few extra filter circuits that can saturate the sound. Instead of using a clean filter type, I will pick a SMP one, and use the additional drive parameter to make the bass warmer. The bass preset is done. What do we do most often with bass sounds in techno? We sidechain them. Instead of a sidechain compression saw, I am using both Shaper and Utility to automate the volume of the bass as if I was using a sidechain compression. I have been covering this technique in a few earlier videos, including the second part of Shran's music production tutorial, so here's just a recap. Shaper is a flexible LFO that can modulate numerous knobs in Ableton with a shape we draw in this window. Using the map button, I assign the modulation to the gain control in the utility. I draw the sidechain curve in the middle section and set the volume level attenuation with the modulation range. It not only enhances the rhythm, but also creates the space for the kick drum to cut through the bass. I want that bass to sound like it's passed through a subtle guitar amplifier. It would be great to just enhance a certain frequency range with saturation to make that happen. The overdrive is the effect we are looking for. With default settings though, the bass sounds too bright. That is why at first time, we will turn down the amount of distortion applied. The tone knob is a post-distortion equalizer that boosts high frequencies. I want my bass to sound muffled, so let's turn it down to zero. Now the most important thing, picking a frequency range that is saturated and enhanced. Even though the drive is set to nearly 0%, According to the Ableton manual, 0% doesn't mean zero distortion, so it still makes sense to control that bandpass filter with both frequency and filter bandwidth controls to pick a narrow range of lower frequencies to make the bass warmer. The dynamics parameter controls the dynamic range of the sound and it influences the distortion in various ways. In our case, turning this down makes the bass even more muffled. In the end, I blend the effect with dry-wet control. You can hear that the bass after saturation is quieter. To give you a better insight on what does the bass sound like with and without the overdrive, I pair it with the utility that compensates the difference in volume. The last effect is the equalizer. Its purpose is to make the sound cleaner. The reason for why the bass sounds now muddy and bloated is because frequencies from around 200 to 300 Hz are too loud. This equalizer will isolate that frequency range. Listen to the bass and notice how much space do these muddy frequencies take as I turn on and off this effect. The next equalizer, through a series of cut-in bell filters, will precisely cut unnecessary bloat from the sound. Filters 7 and 8 will add a bit more clarity and brightness to the sound. The first filter, that is a high-pass one, will remove the sub-frequencies out of the bass. That is because these sub-frequencies will come from the kick drum we will create soon. Without that high-pass filter, we would let the low frequencies from both bass and kick to overlap, and this often makes the mix sound weak. Because we cut lots of frequencies, we should add a few decibels of output gain to judge better what does the equalizer do indeed. Let me play for a while the finished beat to show you the importance of that high-pass filter. Without that filter, you will notice the low end is not as solid as it should be. The bass is finished and it's time to add the kick drum. I want to have an aggressive 909 kick sound. The drum synth kick is a great instrument for making this kind of kicks. I have covered deeply this instrument in my 9x9 AC techno tutorial, so here I will just explain the settings. An aggressive 909 kick needs punch, that I achieve with high envelope value. To make the sound fatter, I use mostly the overdrive distortion. The kick has to fill the beat with sub-frequencies, so with higher decay, I make this kick long enough. The sub-frequency is set to around 46 Hz, given deep bass. This raw 909 sounds like this. To make sure that each kick drum will be exactly the same, I export a single kick and sequence it in a new audio channel. On that audio channel, I will process the kick further with effects. The first effect is the saturator that will slightly enhance the mid-frequencies. Inside of the saturator, I applied a soft sine wave shaper curve for subtle distortion. The drive knob is set low, and that's all I need to emphasize gently the mid end. I don't intend to trash the sound, so I don't even use the bottom section of the saturator that I usually use for aggressive distortion. What we need in larger amounts, though, are mid-frequencies that give the kick punch. With these mid-frequencies, the kick will pierce through the beat much better. At first, I will isolate the frequency area I'm talking about. In the equalizer, I use again a series of bell filters. Instead of cutting frequencies, they will boost now the frequency area I have isolated a while ago. Notice the third filter that cuts a similar frequency range we attenuated in the bass sound. This will make the kick sound cleaner. I will play the kick now and turn on and off the whole equalizer. Notice how much punch we are adding with equalization alone. What if I would like to add even more punch and some extra distortion, but only in the beginning of the kick? It's time for a sound design trick. I will use the overdrive once again. This time, I will enhance a higher frequency area and add even more high-end with the tone knob. The kick is much brighter, but the distortion is too heavy. I will make the overdrive more transparent by turning down both drive and dynamics. The only thing left is the dry-wet control. If we leave it as it is now, the kick has more punch, but we are losing the low end in the latter part of the kick. If I set the dry-wet to 0, we keep the bass, but we don't get any extra punch. The solution is to attach another shaper that modulates the dry-wet control. With such settings, I let the overdrive process only the beginning of the kick. In that way, I keep both low end and punch. To make our kick fuller, I will layer it with some other kick sample. I will use a kick sample that has a crispy high end but without any hi-hat present. This kick sample is way too long. I only want a beginning part of it. I can trim the sample to make it shorter. And if I encounter any weird clicks, I can add some fade in and fade out to remove them. I have already done everything in another pad. This is the sample I will equalize now. The equalization starts with removing any lower frequencies that could overlap with the main kick sound. In that way, I avoid getting a muddy sound. Filters from 3 to 5 do precise cuts that remove certain resonating frequencies I found unpleasant. For better context, I will turn on these filters while the main kick drum is playing in the background. At last, I use a high shelf filter to cut the high end heavily. I could do the same with a low-pass filter, but a shelf filter just suited the sample more. We blend this kick sample with the main kick by turning down its volume. It's time for group processing that affects both kick samples and the bass channel. The first effect is the multiband compressor that I use to sculpt the mid frequencies. Compressing the mid frequencies while leaving the low ones untouched gives us a more solid kick that keeps its low end full and deep. I have been using the multiband compressor for the exact same purpose in my 9x9 AC techno tutorial, where I explained this technique and the multiband dynamics affect itself for straight 8 minutes. If you don't know anything about multiband compression, I recommend heavily to watch at least that part of the 9x9 tutorial. Here I will only compare the kick and bass sound with and without the multiband compression. I need even more punch on the kick sound, so let me show you a simple way for getting that. A classic thing would be to use a compressor on the main kick itself that makes the latter part of the sound quieter. It's safe to simplify things and say we can substitute such a compressor with a simple volume automation that makes the kick louder in the beginning, and that's the approach I am taking. After the multiband dynamics effect, I am using for yet another time, the shaper with utility. Both modulation shape and modulation range are set up to make everything but the beginning of the kick quieter. To just make sure the modulation will not harm by accident the very beginning transient of the kick, I add in the end of the modulation curve a fast ramp up shape. The second utility, after the shaper, compensates the volume difference, so I can show you now how to compress the kick without any compressor. The last thing I can do to make the sound fuller is to distort the whole group. This is a parallel processing applied with the audio effect rack. Inside of that rack, I have two processing chains. The first chain plays the kick and bass without any changes. The second chain will be distorted. I know from experience that crispy tape saturation-like textures can be added with heavy distortion, like in the amp effect. I will add the amp now and preview to you a few distortion styles. Picking the right style is the first step towards adjusting this effect. The overall amount of distortion is dialed with the gain knob. To keep the crispy sound, I will avoid adding too much of it. The next is the equalization section. Sometimes it works as intended. For example, I can use the treble knob to boost or cut the highest frequencies. But with heavy distortion, we can have a situation where the middle and bass knobs behave unpredictably. Instead of boosting or cutting the low end, they change the distortion itself. We can still make use of these knobs to fine-tune the character of distortion. The presence knob is another way to control the brightness of the sound. I will make the sound even darker by turning this down. I can slightly decrease the volume of the output with the volume knob. But because I'm using the amp as the part of parallel processing, I keep the tri-wet control at 100%. So, what to do with such a distorted mess? After the amp, I use both low and high pass filters to remove unnecessary low, mid and high frequencies. We want to keep only the meaty part of the sound. The distorted layer can be added now to the main beat. Don't forget to adjust the volume of it. I have already done that inside of the audio effect track, and now I can show you how does this layer make the whole beat sound richer.